Hi dear students, here Vetrimani Ilangovan. In this video I'm going to explain you quicksort algorithm with C program. So we know that quicksort is one of the efficient algorithm for sorting an element, right? So let's start with the example. Quicksort. So I'm going to take an example array. So let me do the algorithm, the sums from left side, and on the right side meanwhile I'll write the program. Okay, so first let's take the array. Array is equal to, I'm going to take 40, 10, 60, 20, 30 and 50, and this is going to be my input, right? So for that we know that what are the line of code to get the input, right? So let's start towards here. Hash include stdio.h, then we have to start the main program, right? And you know that we are going to use two functions. The first function is going to be partitioning function, and second one is going to be a sort function, right? So let me write this. I'll explain you why we are writing this. Okay, so void, first function is going to be quicksort. We are going to pass parameter an array first, and next we are going to pass two parameters, which are first and last index of the array. Okay, and second I'm going to add one more function. It will have a return type, that's why I'm using integer int partition. Array name is partition. Here also I'm going to pass three parameters, array and first and last value of the array, given array. Okay, so next we are going to start our main program. Int main, and here I'm going to get this array. Okay, so for getting input as array, we know that we have to declare the array first, integer a, and here you can give whatever value you want, and then I is for iteration purpose to get the input by using for loop, and n is going to be the boundary. Okay, so now I'm going to ask printf. So simply I don't want to write enter the value for n and enter the number of value like that. I'm going to use simply n. I'm going to ask the value for n. Okay, and because it will consume much time, I'm going to scan. Now I have got the value. N value is, what is the value of n here? N is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we have 6 data. Okay, then I'm going to get the input now, the element for the array. So printf, so here you can ask that enter the element like that. So just write like enter the elements, and scanf, before going to go to scanf, so we have to introduce the loop, for loop. I is equal to 0, I less than or equal to n minus 1, and I plus plus. So then you can go for scanf, and here you can do percentage d, and you're going to pass it into array, right? Here it is going to be I. So we have imported the array. Okay, now I have got n value and I've got the elements as well. Okay, now what is going to be the next step? So we know that the operation is going to be quicksort. We are going to sort the element by using quicksort algorithm. So already I have initiated quicksort function over here. I'm going to call the function. So simply I'm going to write quicksort, the function name, and so the parameters are, what is the first parameter over here? It is going to be integer array. It is going to be array. So array is nothing but a. And next it is going to be integer, the starting index, which is nothing but 0. Of course the starting index you can see over here, it is going to be 0, right? And next, the last index, we are going to pass the last index for this. So last index value is 5. 5 means nothing but n minus 1. So the parameters are a comma 0 comma n minus 1. A which is nothing but an array, and 0 is going to be the starting index, and n minus 1 is going to be the last index. Okay, so that's it. I have passed the function, I have called the function over here. Then what I have to do is I have to go for printing the value, right? After sorting, so we have to print the output, right? So simply you can write that printf, and here you can write after printing, after sorting, or something like that. After sort, then so here also you have to use for loop. I is equal to 0, I less than or equal to n minus 1, and I plus plus, right? So here you can use the scanf, right? So it is going to be now here no need of scanf, and you have to return the value. It is going to be 0, right? So these two lines are used to print the output. Okay, about this we will see later. Okay, so here we know that the line of codes, it is for initializing the variable and for asking the input, and after for getting the input, and we are going to introduce the function quicksort. So this is going to be important. And then sir, you can ask that, sir, we have used one more function, partition, but why didn't used? So we will use the partition function inside to the quicksort function. Okay, so let's start from here. Let's go back to the problem, how we are going to solve this problem. So as per divide and conquer strategy, so what we supposed to do is we have to divide the given array by using some strategies, okay, by applying some method. So here the given array is 40 10 60 20 30 50. So as per the DC strategy as well as the quicksort method, we have an algorithm for partitioning. So for that we are going to introduce a pivot variable for partition the given data. So you can ask that what is pivot variable, sir? How we can choose the pivot variable from the given data? Which is very simple, and we have many methods to choose the pivot value. And you can choose the first value, you can choose the last value, you can choose the median value. And for this problem we are going to choose the first one, the first value as pivot value. Okay, so what are the things we have to initialize? Is first thing is here I will write the given data again: 40 10 60 20 30 and 50. This is going to be the given data. And let me zoom my screen. Okay, yeah, so first data is, first I'm going to find, I'm going to keep initialize the pivot value. So pivot, which is nothing but p, I'm going to, I mean it's going to be the new variable, and I'm going to assign first value as pivot value. Okay, and left is going to be, of course, so let's see, pivot value, and left is starting index, and our right is going to be the last index. So L is equal to, so you can, it is going to be the first index, that is 0, and R is going to be the last index, n minus 1. So that's it. So this is going to be the three important variable for partitioning. Okay, and that, let me explain the procedure one by one. Okay, so here we have a condition that you can call it as a case. So the thing is, let me call the quicksort partition algorithm once again. So if L is less than P, what you have to do is you have to move the L pointer towards right side. You have to move the L pointer towards right side. That means L plus plus. Okay. And next is, if R is greater than pivot value, or here R is greater than pivot value, what you have to do is you have to move the R pointer towards left, which means or minus minus. Here moving towards right and left is nothing but we are going to increase the index value and we are going to decrease the index value. That means R will go towards like in this direction and L will go towards right direction. Okay, so you can ask that, sir, only these two cases are there. Yes, we have only two cases, and at of course if the condition is not satisfied, what you have to do is you have to swap with the corresponding value. Corresponding value can be L or right with, so we cannot write like this. So if the condition is fails for the first condition, so what you have to do is you have to swap the L value with pivot, and for this R value with pivot. This is going to be the condition. We have to apply this condition for partitioning the given data. Okay, so let's see. So here is the given data and I'm going to start solving from the top. Okay, so A is equal to 40, 10, 60, 20, 50, of course, yeah, 50. So this is going to be the given data, and let's give a pointer to pivot value, and or it is going to be, sorry, it is L and this is going to be R. Okay, so for that, let's see. So first step is I'm going to check, I'm going to start from L. Okay, so of course here the condition is if L less than or equal to P, but we cannot perform this operation because already L and pivot pointer points to the same data. That means if the condition is true, means you can go for a next case, right? But here the condition is not true. What you have to do is you have to start from the right side. So if R is greater than P, that means the second case, if R is greater than P, what you have to do is you have to decrement the position of R pointer, right? So here what is the value? R is 50, greater than what is the value of P? It is 40. Yes, of course it satisfies. What you have to do is you have to decrement. So 40, 10, 60, 20 and 50, this is the given data. P points to the same, P and L points to the same data, and after applying this move, now R will points to 20. That means from here we are decrementing the position. Then apply the next condition, then we have to go for another again, the loop will go again and check that if 20 is greater than 40, whether the condition is true. No, the condition is not satisfied. What you have to do is you have to swap 20 with 40. That means what is going to be the result over here? See, it is going to be 40, sorry, we have to swap, right? 20, 10, 60, 40 and 50. Now so it's fine, right? So now L points to the first data, but now P changed to over here, right? P is always the value what we are assigning at first initialization. It has to be it cannot be changed after any moment. Okay, and only L and R position will get changed. Now P and R points to the same position, right? That means we cannot proceed from this side. Now what you have to do is you have to change the position. So you have to come over here, then you have to start checking the value from this side. 20, 10, 60, 40 and 50. Now R and P points to the same data, and sorry, L points to the first data. Okay, now compare, now apply the first case. That means let me show you that. The first condition is if L less than P, we have to move the left pointer towards right, right? That means L plus plus. So here if 20 less than 40, pivot value is 40, right? So yes, condition satisfies. What you have to do is L plus plus 20, 10, 60, 40, 50. Now L will move to here and R and P remains same. Now apply the next condition. What is the next condition? The same condition. So 10 less than 40, of course it satisfies. So you have to move the pointer towards right, L plus plus. Then it is going to be here 20, 10, 60, 40 and 50. Now see, now L will points to 60 and R will points to 40 and P remains same, right? Yeah. Now still we have one more step. Then again apply the same condition. If 60 is less than 40, is this true? No, it is false. That means what is going to be the operation? We have to swap L with P. That means swap 60 with 40. Then let's see, after swapping 20, 10, 40, 60, 50, right? So now let's find out the pivot values. P is here and L is here. L points to 60 and R points to, sorry, L points to 40 and R points to 60 now, right? So simply we have swapped the data. Now what you have to do is, now we cannot proceed from left pointer, right? Then you have to go to right pointer. The condition is if R greater than P. So let's see, condition is if 60 greater than pivot value. Yes, it's satisfied. So what you have to do, you have to decrement the position of R, right? Then 20, 10, 40, 60, 50. Now pivot points to 40 and both R and L points to the same data. So what is the first condition? The condition is if L is equal to R, L is equal to R, or else if L is greater than or equal to R, then we have to stop. That means that is going to be the partition step. So after that, we have to split the given array. See, we have to split the given array by 20, 10 is going to be one partitioned array and 40 is going to be the pivot value and 60, 50 is going to be the second partitioned array. A1, A2 and this is going to be P. So that's it. Now we have completed the partition and as per the quicksort partition rule, so given data, I mean the left array should have the lesser value when you compare it with the pivot value and right subarray will have greater value when you compare it with pivot value. So that's it. So the everything is fine. So let's go to the coding part. So it's better I can write at bottom, that's fine. Okay, so let me start from the partition program. Okay, so here integer partition, integer, the parameters are integer array A and integer L, it is going to be left end, I mean starting index, integer R is going to be the last index of the given array. Okay, so first step is we are going to initialize, we are going to declare the variable P, which is pivot variable, I and J for indicating the index of L and R, and a temporary variable for swapping the data. And first initialize the value for V, I mean P. So P is nothing but the starting index of the value, which means array of L. Okay. And next is I value, which is nothing but it is going to be L, that means starting index. And we are going to introduce two new variable, which is I and J, for the purpose of identification of the indexes, because we are going to change the index, right? So for that, and J is going to be R plus 1. Okay, so first step, I'm not going to use if condition for checking the cases. Okay, So here I'm going to introduce a do while. So that will be better. It will give you, it will reduce some line of codes, okay, instead of using if condition. So do, and here I'm going to introduce one more do for checking the condition. First condition is I don't remember that I is for left index, and J is for right index. That means left to go will towards like R plus, I mean L plus plus, that means I plus plus, and right will go towards left side, that means J minus minus. So this is going to be the two important operation that we know that. So when we can go, when we can move towards right, and when we can move the J towards left, when I can increment and when I can decrement. So for this, I have introduced two do statement, and I'm going to write the condition first. First, as we know that, first I'm going to increment I plus plus. When I can increment I plus plus, that means while. So what is the condition? Array of I is less than pivot value, as well as array is less than or equal to R. That means it cannot exceed the last index. Okay, so then I'm going to introduce one more step, which is do. After that, yes, I have write a condition for I plus plus, right? Then J minus minus. So what is going to be the condition for J minus minus? Which is nothing but just write J minus minus while right array of J is greater than pivot value, which is P, right? And this is going to be the condition here. From right side to left side we are moving, so there is no need, or else if you want to write the another condition you can use, okay, but this is not required now. So the next step is we have to find out one more condition that yes of course we have completed all, right? So for moving towards right and left, the next condition is if the condition is not satisfied, then what you have to do. That means if I is less than J, then what you have to do, then we have to go for the swap. That means we are going to swap the given data, I mean with array of I with array of J. That means temp is equal to array of I is equal to array of J, and array of J is equal to temp, right? So if the condition not satisfied, and next you can ask that then what is the use of first do, sir? First we have introduced one do loop now, sir. Then for that what we have to do, we are going to apply one more condition for as a closing loop for the condition, which is nothing but again we are going to apply while I less than or equal to J, and here which is nothing but we are going to assign the value, because we are going to return what we are going to return. We are going to return the value of that means a J. We are going to return J, which is nothing but R index. That means we are going to split the given array. So while doing the quick sort function, you will get a clear idea. That means we are going to partition the given array by using the J index. J index what? That means see, we are going to split. Now you can ask that here we have a pivot value, and ask that the starting index is going to be L and ending index is going to be R, right? So after splitting, we'll be having a J. That means it will start from here for the splitted array, and J will be here. And so what's the pivot value will points to J. That means the first subarray is going to be starts from L to J minus 1, and next is going to be the pivot value, and right is J plus 1, from J plus 1 to R. That means that the next index, okay, and that's how we are going to sort the array, okay, for combining the data. So we are going to return the pivot value. That means so what you have to do is, so first let me assign the pair value, that means the L value to the J value, I mean the jth index, and the j index, which is nothing but it is going to be the pivot value, right? So that's it. So the conditions are very simple, and finally you can go for return j. So don't forget that why we are return j. J is going to be the index of, that means you can call it as mid index, j minus 1 and j plus 1. Okay, so that's it. That's all about the partition data, I mean partitioning the data. And next go to quicksort function. So for writing quicksort function, it's going to be very simple because it's not going to return any value. We are going to use the return value of partition function. So void quicksort, the parameters are going to be integer array and integer l. So the parameter for both partition and quicksort is going to be same, integer l and integer r. So that what is important, we know that the input, main input is going to be j, which is nothing but it is going to be the returned value of the given data, okay, and given function, that is partition. So first compare that whether it has a data or not. That means you are going to check if l is less than or r. That means of course it is going to have data, it's not null. And let's assign the value for j, which is nothing but the return value of the partition function. So the partition function input parameters is a, l and r, right? So that we are going to apply the quicksort function recursively by introducing quicksort array. Of course it is going to be the input, I mean we are going to pass the array into it, and but the starting and last index, as I told you, while returning the value of j, it is going to be like, so from l to j minus 1. So then the next quicksort recursive function is array, of course, and so we know that the index, I mean the boundaries, right, it starts from l to j and r, right? So we have splitted, j points to the pivot value, right? And then what is going to be the boundary value? So l to, of course, j minus 1, right? And we want to start from the next index, that is j plus 1. Already we have created one quicksort for the left subarray, right? Then for right subarray, then we have to start from j plus 1 to the index r, right? So that's all. We have called the function recursively again and again until we met the condition this, okay? So that's it for the quicksort function. So if you apply this, you'll get the expected output. So I hope that you have understood the logics very well, and let me show you the programming result. Let me open my code. So here, this is the code as I explained you through the whiteboard. Here I have introduced two function, quicksort and partition function, and here I'm asking for the element, I mean the number of element is going to be, and the input. Here you can see that I'm asking that value for, I mean the I'm calling the function quicksort, and inside to the quicksort function I'm calling the partition function. You can see over here, so it is going to be the partition function. So I'm passing the variable, you can see that input is going to be array and left and right index. And next, while seeing looking onto the partition function, you can see here the index variables are pij temp, and you can look over here for i++, the condition is for moving the I index towards right, this is going to be the condition, it has to be less than pivot value. And for moving the right index, that means j towards left side, that means j minus minus, for that condition is there I have written in a different way, that means a of j greater than p, of course both are same, you can write like this also. And again we are checking the condition for if not, then it is going to be the swapping of the pivot variable, I mean we are swapping the pivot position, not the pivot variable. That's why we are not using any additional auxiliary variable for pivot. It is going to be constant, okay, we just only we are going to change the index of left and right, okay. And next here you can look for assigning, for returning the j value. I am checking the condition whether I is less than or equal to j, of course. Then I am assigning l, which is nothing but I mean the last index. L will points to where it will point. L will point to, so after completing the swapping operation, L will point, L and R points to the same data, pivot data, right? So array of L, I am assigning the value, that is array of j, and array of j, which is nothing but it is going to be the pivot value, of course, and I am returning the value j. That's it. So just go for execution. Yes. So let me give the number of element. I'm going to give 4, and let's enter the number of elements 40, 30, 20 and 10. So that's it. So it's working. And one more thing is, unfortunately we cannot check that how the partition is are happening, okay. So if you are about to use bubble sort, insertion, or whatever sort you are using, of course the result is going to be same, but quick sort will be the optimal ideal sorting method, that it will give you a less time complexity when you compare it with other sorting strategies, okay. Of course match sort also will give the same time complexity. And one more limitation what we are having in quick sort is in some case if you are choosing the first element as the pivot value, in some case the case is very crucial, that if you are going to give a sorted element, that means a sorted array, if you are going to give the input as sorted element, means so the time complexity will be very high, because the purpose, if you are going to choose the first one, means it will apply the partition function again and again, until that means if the n value is 4, means it will go to 4 times, it will execute the same operation to get to partition the data, okay. So that's all about quicksort. I hope you have understood the logics very well, and if you have any doubts you can ask. And let me explain one more concept in here. So you just try to connect with this step. If you are clear with this step, that means about why we are assigning the values over here. So in the partitioning function, why we are assigning the values, you have to understand the boundaries. So why I'm assigning array of j for p, okay. So otherwise the return value will be different, then the total program will get collapsed, okay. So that's all about this. It's so far 36 minutes video, and thanks for watching. And if you have any doubts you can ask, and thank you.